Hey, what's up, guys? Thank you so much for tuning back in to another episode of We the People. We are slowly coming up on the end of season two. Can you believe it? Today, we sit down with Bushra Amiwala. She is the first and youngest Muslim woman to run for a seat on the Cook County Board of Commissioners. I saw her story on social media as she was highlighted in Teen Vogue and Glamour magazine, and wanted to sit down with her myself and learn a little bit about her experience in running for this position and also figure out where she got her inspiration to make this happen. I hope that you are just as inspired as I was by this story. Let's check it out.
So my name is Bushra Amiwala. I'm currently an undergraduate sophomore at DePaul University. And this past election cycle, I ran for the Cook County Board of Commissioners. I was the first Pakistani Muslim woman to ever get my name on a Cook County ballot. And I was the youngest person to ever run for this seat. I ended up in a three-person race with 30% of the vote this past March, which was around 13,500 votes, which was huge and it was great. But my team was all young people, people of color, people from millennial backgrounds as well, because I couldn't afford to pay and hire staff. And in turn, we had this slew of individuals who truly wanted to work on my campaign because they saw that as a way to make a difference and didn't expect compensation or anything in return. So I'm a student, an activist, a community volunteer, and a former candidate for the Cook County Board of Commissioners. I was born and raised in Rogers Park until I was 9 years old, and then I moved to the beautiful, diverse village of Skokie, and we moved because of the better schooling. And seeing the disparity between the two education systems that I saw growing up within two neighborhoods that were only 3 miles apart became a driving principle for me. I realized the impact that adequate education had on me and the impact and opportunities that it led me to have. So I was always on a journey to somehow better the school systems to equalize the playing field. And I think that's what sparked my journey in activism and later in politics, because I realized the best way to make long-term tangible change was through public policy. So I think people thought it was extremely, I think people are very taboo when it comes to partisanship. If you are a Democrat, never even look at a Republican. Like, it was so strange to me. And a lot of my friends, we never really talked about politics in high school, but after my senior year of high school, it was the summer of 2016, I had a lot of friends tell me that they'd be voting for Donald Trump to be president. And that's when I realized that I was friends with people who were Republican, but I had no idea what Republicans cared about. I was like, I think they hate immigrants, and I think they want to lower taxes, and that's all I got. But I looked at my friends and I was like, these are good people. So what issue precedes this sort of ignorant bigotry and racism that our current president and at that time presidential candidate is spewing that you'll compromise for? And I was sort of embarrassed to ask my own friends that question. So the opportunity came up to work for our senator at the time, who happened to be Republican senator. Nonetheless, it was an incredible opportunity to work for him. And I specifically applied for the field position because with that, we were collecting polling data. So we would go to certain neighborhoods and ask various registered Republican voters a series of 5 questions, which later the Republican senator, Mark Kirk, would shape public policy around. And we never have to tell anyone to vote for Mark Kirk. And the most we'd maybe have to do is wear a shirt that says his name on it, which later became optional anyways, because people were more receptive to opening the door to someone wearing casual clothing. And the reason why I stayed was because these questions were presented on an application, so it was an app. So when I clicked start, that's when I saw what the questions were. So it wasn't until I was standing at my first home when I saw what the first question was, and it was, on a scale of 1 to 10, how fearsome are you of an Islamic terror attack on US soil? And asking that question, knowing that I look like this, on someone's front porch who is about to answer 10, was just an experience that I think is so powerful, because when will you ever be able to, in a social setting, be able to ask someone that question, hear the response, know it's 10, and then say, why? My question would be 1.5, which was why? And almost every single time, the universal answer became, you're the first Muslim person I've met, which most probably was not the case, but I was probably the first Muslim person who looked Muslim that they met or who wore a hijab, in a way that my religion was outwardly displayed in a manner where it was easy to presume that I was Muslim. I felt so otherized. And I went back to the Kirk office and I would say, guys, people keep saying 10. very fearsome. Like, what's up with that? And they're like, Bushra, like, if you're the first Muslim person they've met, what do you think their perception of Muslims are? And it's what's portrayed on the media. They're like, can you show me a positive example of Muslims doing good for society? And I was like, challenge accepted. And I went home and I did research and I found the guy who invented algebra was Muslim. I was like, that's like old, people don't even like math. And the guy that invented coffee was Muslim, but that's also an old example. And then I tried to find current up-to-date examples of Muslims contributing positive things to society and like the way that was being covered. And I found this student who was a freshman in high school named Ahmad, who built a very impressive clock, who was invited by the Obama administration to showcase this clock. But before that, he was suspended because people thought his clock was a bomb. And then there was Malala, the youngest person to ever win a Nobel Peace Prize in education. But she was shot while defending education first. So as Muslims, we were always either victimized or the perpetrators of violence. And it made no sense and there was no in between. And once I decided to run for office, I noticed that people wanted me to fit the mold of the poor Muslim woman hurt by the Trump administration and now she's running for office. When in reality, I was running for the Board of Commissioners, so there was no correlation in that realm. So when I first was speculating the Board of Commissioners, a lot of people were like, yeah, that's a really boring position. And we predominantly deal with public health and public safety, so Cook County Hospital and Cook County Jail. And our money comes from property taxes. But what specifically drew me to this position was that it was a part-time position. So as a student, it's something where it's a large enough office where I can make a tangible, large-scale impact, but small enough where I can manage it while still being a student. And second, you only have to be 18 to run for this office, whereas others, it's 25, 35. This one, I was old enough to do so. And then third, it was a board seat. So I didn't want to be the single governing entity or body because as a first-time candidate and first-time elected official, I can see why people would be nervous for that. But when you're elected onto a board of commissioners, you have to work with 16 other elected officials to make policy that would impact Cook County as a whole. And I think it was very imperative to have someone who looked like me, who was from my background, who was young, a woman, and that perspective that wasn't really present before. So that's why I specifically chose the Board of Commissioners. So traditionally people who are running for office, they try to get a lot of money from a few people. So they'll have a fundraising dinner with 15 people and the cost to attend will literally be $1,000. Whereas I had a fundraising dinner with 450 people and the tickets were $50 or $25 if you're a student and we raised $30,000. So it's really nice that I was involved in many different communities who, even if maybe some of the people who attended my dinner couldn't vote for me, they contributed financially, even if it was just $50. So for me, it was more people putting in less money, like less amounts of money to my campaign, and that's how I fundraised. And again, wouldn't see a gubernatorial candidate having a fundraiser that large because people would rather have fewer people donating large sums of money because it's easier. I think one of the reasons why my campaign had so much traction built around it wasn't because I was running for the Board of Commissioners and it wasn't because of the policy I was presenting. Because when it came to what I could do with this position, the other candidates could have done so as well. There's only so much you could do on the Board of Commissioners, but it's because of why I was doing it. And if you keep pushing what can be done, that's how you win someone's mind. But I was pushing why I'm doing it, and that's how I won people's hearts. And those people still follow my Facebook page, and they still follow my day-to-day journey and what I'm doing politically, and now I attend events, and I don't speak as many events as I was before, but I still attend and I still network and I still get coffee with individuals and see ways I can get involved. I'm not sure if I'll run for office again, but I definitely will encourage and give younger people, people of minority backgrounds, the tools needed to run for office because that experience in itself is something I didn't even have. And I think having sort of that mentor or guide or someone to just turn to when you have a simple question that you're scared to ask someone else in fear of thinking, well, maybe it's because I'm young and naive, I'll be that person for them. And currently I'm going to finish up my undergrad majoring in accountancy or finance of some sort and then go to law school. And I think that will strengthen my background in a more diverse setting, especially if I seek to run for office again sometime. I think the advice I would give to people who fit in the unknown category would be the counter example. So you can't just be angry at people for having predisposed beliefs for certain groups of people because of what they see in the media when you personally can't serve as a reason why that's not true. And I think that's one of the motivating factors of me running for office, because there's this negative stereotype that Muslim women are shy, timid, and passive, which are fine traits, but that's associated to us being quote unquote oppressed. And if me running for elected office is a reason why someone doesn't think that anymore, then I am serving as the counterexample. And for those who are as narrow-minded, I think recognizing that that's an issue is the first step, but also us who are generalized, we need to recognize that no one will go out of their way to find a counterexample, which is why you have to show up, speak out. Our voices have so much power, but they have even more power when we speak collectively. I think my American dream is being at this place where I have an education that my parents were never able to receive, and where I can support them financially so they don't have to stress about car payments or home payments, and where I can raise people or children one day in a society where you live doesn't impact the kind of education you receive. Because to me, it's just heartbreaking to know that your geographic location can literally be a factor in where you see yourself or where you end up in the future when it comes to opportunities. And I think my American dream also would be making it so the playing field is even, not completely even, because I recognize that's impossible, but a bit more even. My advice is everything happens for a reason. I did not win when I ran for office, but what did I have to lose? Nothing. I knew going into this that regardless of whether I won or I lost, even if I lost, I'd still be on square one. So there's nothing that you can lose from just trying. Only good can come out of that. And I also think intentions speak louder than actions sometimes. So people with good intentions will make it far, because good things happen to good people. So as long as your intentions and your heart is in the right place, whatever you end up doing, it can't go wrong.